Hey, you guys, welcome back to the channel. Today I'm going to introduce you guys to my husband, Chris Hammond. You guys have been asking for a video about my husband and my relationship, and this week has basically been dedicated to LGBTQIA plus issues, and I figured what better way to kind of jump in terms of my place in there than to introduce you to my husband and to maybe talk a little bit about our relationship and, you know, how we met and what this relationship means to both of us. This is also take two. We started doing this on my phone, and then I remembered that last night when I tried to post a video from my phone, the computer wasn't working. It wasn't dealing with the phone file well, and so we're gonna do it this way, completely unedited. Not completely unedited, but mostly unedited.
Better edit.
It's gonna be mostly unedited. So another thing is I want to let you guys know that my husband is a very, very, very private person, and so this is a huge deal that he's even bothering to do this, and so, be supportive, be nice. So when we did this the first time around, we started just talking about the fact that over the course of our relationship, there have been changes that have kind of created some divisions between us, and I'm guessing that there are also places where we've come together. Like, when, you know, we came, you know, obviously there's the fact that we're, you know, interracial couple, and that I'm vegan and, you know, strongly embrace those principles, and Chris is not vegan. And for most of our relationship, we both weren't vegan, so, you know, that creates some stuff. We'll talk a little bit about that. But we jumped right in talking about the role of race and, you know, talking about how when we first met, what effect, impact, part did the fact that I was a black person play in our coming together. So for you, like, here's this black person, what were you thinking, and how were you feeling that was impacting our relationship, or why was, what made you even want to step into a relationship with someone who was, you know, an African American?
So I think, you know, I'd always been attracted to black guys, and in reality, I don't know whether that really was being attracted to black guys or not finding white guys attractive. And, you know, I don't know what that may have to do with my own image of myself and, you know, not finding myself especially attractive. And so, you know, I can't say it wasn't something I thought about, because it was, people make a thing of it, right? Why are you always dating black guys or whatever? Not mm-hmm. that I was even dating that many people, but, and my answer has always sort of been, I don't know, I am. I check myself to make sure it wasn't coming out of some sort of stereotype of what the black men I was interested in were supposed to act like or talk like or be interested in. And generally, I don't think it was or is. So I've never felt the need to explain it. Mm-hmm. I've had people who have told me, you know, well, it'll be much harder for you. And my response has generally been, most people are not going to say, there's a black man and a white man walking down the street holding hands. Oh my God, they're an interracial couple.
Now
that's not the world we really were living in 1996.
It's funny because I'm hearing this and I understand where you're going with this, but please explain what you mean by that, because it might go over some people's heads.
I just, you know, being gay at that time for me and my impression, and I think greatly in reality, in the Midwest, was a much bigger deal than dating someone being attracted to people of a different race. Mm-hmm. Much more problematic, much more explanation required, you know, a whole coming out process in a way there's not. I mean, sometimes people are surprised. I think my mother was surprised the first time a black man came home with me, but
who wasn't me, but
it was not you.
I'm just, and I was just assuming that, but I don't think it was me.
It was not you. But you know, it wasn't. It was so what, and the so what wasn't assumed, you know, coming out as gay. So, I think, you know, being in a interracial relationship never really struck me as a big deal at that time.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting, because the first time I said this when we were making this video before, it was the first time I think that you were hearing it, and you can tell me if you agree, but I admitted that there was probably some internalized, you know, white supremacist ideals about beauty that were operating that made me attracted to, you know, Chris, to you, when we first met. I'm not necessarily a person who's just gonna meet someone and like be attracted to them, but there was something about Chris's appearance when I met him that, you know, just, you know, jumped out in my mind as this very traditionally Western, traditionally in the Western sense, attractive man. And I was pretty much aware that you, like, he looked at me in a way that was just like very like, okay, he clearly was excited to see me, and I didn't know what that was about, but there was something about having someone who looked like him excited about me that I found like kind of exciting and validating in a strange way. And I'm comfortable talking about that now because I'm aware of what was probably operating at that time. I'm not saying that it necessarily was, but it is very likely. Because it would not have been the only time that I kind of sort of uplifted whiteness, or that I've experienced whiteness being uplifted in a way that was just, you know, commonplace. And I don't want to get too much into that, but can you talk about what it was like for you to hear me saying that? Like, what does that mean to think that, you know, I might have been attracted to you because of, you know, some embracing of white supremacist ideology?
Well, I mean, I think it bothers me in the sense that if that implies a negative self-image, then that's really kind of sad. And it's sad to think that there are people going through their lives, or there have been people going through their lives, you know, carrying that around, and carrying around the idea that, you know, they're not beautiful, or they're not able to be successful because they're not white. So I think that's kind of sad. It doesn't, you know, for me, there's people have whatever physical attraction they have. And, you know, you find someone attractive because they have blonde hair, or because they're tall, or they're, you know, whatever, muscly or not muscly, or, you know, and it is what it is. And you can spend a lot of time analyzing it, or you can just say that's, you know, that's who I am. It was shaped by various things in my lives, but and it's probably helpful to try to uncover those things just for, you know, the sense of self-knowledge. But I don't think it's terribly helpful to go through life criticizing yourself because you're attracted to the wrong sort of person, or you're attracted to the people you're attracted to. And I don't feel bothered that you at one time were attracted to me because of certain physical characteristics that I had that I'm not in control of, and you know, is not, it's just the way you are.
So, and you know, I don't want to, you know, spend all of our time talking about like just the fact that, like, the fact of us being, you know, that I'm African American, that he's, you know, European American. That's what, like, I think it's Swedish,
English, British.
But more like, how has that, like, what are the issues that have manifested themselves, or what are the, like, values and, like, kind of rewards of having a relationship that's interracial for you?
Oh, I think it's an awareness. First and foremost, it just has brought me an awareness of different kinds of people in the world, and it's, you know, to go too far down that path, you know, now it's sort of seeing people as just their, you know, whatever their type is, seeing them as objects, almost fetishizing that. But, you know, whoever I might have been in a long-term relationship with, I'm sure I would have met beautiful people in their families. Meeting your family, meeting all of the different people in your family who have had very different lives than most of the people in my family, because of where they live, because of what they do for work, because of their, you know, their background, because of being black, is, you know, just, it's opened the door to seeing the greater complexity, I guess, let me put it that way, of American life in the 21st century that some people don't see. And it's, you know, every now and then I'll be on Facebook and some friend of a friend or something will make some dumbass comment, and I will just click through and see if I can see that person's friends. And, you know, there was one woman who was going off on a rant about Black Lives Matter and so forth. And it wasn't especially because, you know, this woman was a friend of a friend. I know her. I didn't feel it was especially my place to comment on it. But I clicked through, and almost every person on her friend list that I could see was a white person. And this is someone who lived in Kansas or Missouri or somewhere. And there were no black people. And I wanted to say, I just wanted to ask, you know, do you know anyone in Black Lives Matter? Because I do. And that's not the impression that I have of them. And so I think, had I not been in a relationship with an African-American person, there are lots of relationships with other friends and people that I would not have. And all of my knowledge about the way, not all, but a great deal of my knowledge about the way African Americans live their lives would have been filtered through some source of media, right? Through television, news, the internet, whatever, books. And it would have been fairly inaccurate, I think. Certainly wouldn't have been rich and nuanced to the extent that it is now. I want to say one more thing, which is kind of a little off topic, but it occurred to me. And it, so if you've read The Color of Water by James McBride, right, his mother talks about, she was a Jewish woman in different interracial marriages with black men, and, you know, having a ridiculous number of kids with them. And
what do you mean by ridiculous number of kids?
14, something like that.
Because some people would, I don't know if everybody would consider that ridiculous, but
fair enough.
It could. Some people would think one is a ridiculous number of kids, right?
Fair enough.
So she had a lot of kids. Okay.
She had a lot of kids.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Go ahead.
And she talks about, you know, being, and she came from an Orthodox Jewish family, so it was, you know, being with someone who wasn't a Jew was problematic. Not being in the arranged marriage they wanted to put her in was a problem. But, you know, she talked about the way that she was accepted in the families of the men that she married, and how there was really not any question about who she was. It was just, are you, you know, are you down or not, mm-hmm. you know?
When you say down or not, that might be...
Are you?
Yes, buddy.
You know, are you sitting down and talking with us like we're people and behaving with us like we're people and like we're family or not? Or are you separating yourself? And, I mean, that's, I don't remember the exact language she used. More articulate than mine, I'm sure. But that's kind of been my experience with your family, I will say. They just, nobody made a deal out of who I was or where I came from.
I'm remembering a particular quote from my mother about this. Do you know the one I have in mind?
I think I probably do.
In my family, oh my God, we just have, I don't know, it's probably in every family, like, you know, there's gossip that goes on. And at one point, I was asking my mother, and I don't know, I think Chris might have been in the car at the time, and I was like, do you guys talk about Chris like this when he's not around? And do you remember what she said?
Oh, I remember.
Well, you say, please repeat what she said.
We don't talk about Chris. We don't have anything negative to say.
I don't know. And it was interesting because it was like, oh, really? The only way that you can be the topic of conversation in this family is if you're a horrible person. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure that's not what she meant, but it was, I just thought that was an interesting story to illustrate what you were talking about.
Yeah, no, I mean, it was just, you know, okay, here's the food and, you know, here's what we're doing. We're watching the game or whatever. And are you going to join us or, you know, not? And, you know, I don't know. And just assume not get into the, you know, my own, how it was. You can get into how it was being received by my own family later, I guess. But I think there's part of why I want to say this is I think there's this stereotype of African Americans and minorities generally of being hostile toward gay people, and that's not at all been my experience.
And you're talking about like at least 100 people, African American people that you've been exposed to through my family, like at a time, in one sitting, right?
Yeah, and it's just come in, sit down at the table. You know, and not really any more than that. Mm. And again, I don't know what your family has said to you, and you had your own coming out process that I'm sure was difficult at times, and with certain people. But you know, I heard on the I was listening to this real twit of a reporter on the radio once, and she was talking with some gay Latino folks, and she was just desperate to get them to talk about how difficult it was to be gay as a Latino person. And the person wouldn't say it. And they, you know, and she tried. She kept trying. And I've never dated a Latino person for an extended period of time and, you know, never had experience of meeting family and so forth. But you know, based on my own experience with African Americans, like that's an assumption that has not been borne out in my case, and that I think it comes from somewhere, and I'm interested in where it comes from and why it's been important to continue stating that as if it's the truth.
Mm-hmm. That there's a particular
type of homophobia toward gay people in among African Americans in the African American church. And, you know, or wherever.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. Okay, so I was going to talk about like engagement in movements. If that's, you know, if you're interested in talking about that, that's cool. There's so many things, you know, people probably want to know about, like, our relationship and, you know, so I feel like anything that you would say about any of those things would be interested in people if you want to kind of capture some of those things in a nutshell that might be interesting to people.
So there's something that came up when we were doing take one, that we were just getting to that, that I've been thinking about since then. And you were talking about the way that, you know, you and your philosophy have changed over the course of our relationship, and particularly becoming vegan and other ways that you've become, I don't necessarily want to characterize it, other ways that your political views have changed and your social views have changed, maybe. And how that, what that experience has been like. And what I started to say was, I think people with more privilege, and I'm going to put it that way, can tend to look at questions of social justice, even if they are philosophically and politically on the right side of them, right? They can look at questions of social justice as if they are academic exercises. And I think that is very much where I was when I met you, and probably still is greatly today. And I remember, you know, you were having a hard time with your work because really of what amounted to political differences and the way that those political differences were manifested in what for you was political work and for what everyone else was a kind of social justice work, but not in any way overtly, but which attempted to exclude anything political, I would say, the way that they did it. And I gave you that piece to read by Althusser, Ideologies and Ideological State Apparatuses, mm-hmm. which you should read. It'll take you a month to get through it.
I'll link to a short video that I'll put a link up here to a short video that I did talking about some of the concepts from that video for people who want just like a little digest of it, but it
took me a month to get through it when I was in graduate school. I mean, it's heavy going, but it's partly heavy going because it's a really comprehensive way of kind of analyzing societies, I think. Mm-hmm. But for me at that time when I gave it to you, it was very much an academic thing. It was, here's a way of looking at the world. And it changed the way that I looked at the world, but it didn't change the way that I acted, especially. Mm. That's interesting. And I think there are a lot of people who I think for me, as you were becoming more radicalized by events in your life, and, you know, as you were putting some new ideas into action, or maybe some ideas you'd had a long time and you felt more free to act upon them, whether it's wherever in terms of social justice that they were, veganism or anything else, you understand them deeply and personally, and it's a matter of life and death for you, I think, in a way that it's not for me. And, you know, I had kind of had that same feeling. I went to a protest rally out at Stonewall for transgender rights. And somebody used the word criminalized. And, you know, I was out there to sort of do the right thing. And I care deeply about transgender kids and, you know, the risks of that they face every day, kids especially. But again, I think, you know, for me, it's not an issue that affects me in my daily life. And suddenly it was, right, the word criminalized wasn't being used metaphorically, right? It was, they might send us to jail or to some sort of institution. There may be actually enacted laws that say we are not fit to walk the street. We are not fit to work. We are not fit to, you know, have relationships, attend school, whatever. It's not an academic issue. And I think that's been, for me, part of the struggle is, as a white cisgender male, gay or otherwise, it's the stakes are lower for me in a lot of social justice issues. They just are. That's the reality. That's the reality of privilege, right? And it's only, you know, it's really only recently that I've become aware of this. I would say it's really only in the last 3-4 years that I've become aware of this at all. And so for me, as you have changed your life and your lifestyle much more rapidly than I think I could or would in, you know, in most circumstances, it's been sort of difficult to catch up. But I think I don't know. I'll sort of leave it there. It's been hard. I haven't necessarily gone all the way with you in some ways. I mean, I'm not vegan. I'm not eating a vegan diet. And maybe that's a matter of lacking the courage of my convictions. I don't know. But it's so that, I mean, that creates tension, right, in a relationship, and I think it's created tension more because we've been far apart over the past 6 months or so, and 9 months, whatever it's been, and so the change continues to happen, and then you come back together, and you're not quite the same person that either of us, not quite the same people that we were, you know, when we'd separated, and so, you know, there's always kind of a moment of, wait, who are you again? But now it's, wait, who are you now? Right? Which is, and I think that's probably true in all long-distance relationships, and that's, you know, one of the things that makes them difficult. It's not the being apart, it's the, when you're back together, kind of reconciling what your memory of this person was with the person that they actually are. So, you know, that we're both gonna, I'm sure there are ways that I've changed. I don't know, and I don't know what they all are, because it's just happening to me and it's gradual. It's water on a stone. But, you know, that's something we just have to continue to work through, as all people in all relationships have to work through their evolution. And my God, if you're not evolving, that's boring. I feel sad. I feel the saddest relationships, you know, are those where people are in the pattern that they've been in for 20 or 30 years and not learning and not continuing to grow as people, whatever that image calls forth for you. Mm.
So I... I feel like there's so many more things that we could talk about. I don't know that we have to try to get to every single thing in this one video. I mean, maybe we could just have a commitment to maybe come back in 6 months and pick up the conversation again. I'm sure that there are people like who just want to know, like, you know, the basics of our relationship, you know, struggles that we go through, you know, what, you know, how we stay together, how we met. Like, so there are a lot of things, and maybe we can come back and talk to them at another time. Is there any, like, one, if you were going to talk about or categorize our relationship for people who might be like, what? How would you, if you are interested in that at all, how would you talk about that kind of in a nutshell? And maybe we can just commit to coming back and getting more clear on it in another video. Maybe when I'm back in April.
You need to ask that again, because I was thinking about something.
What were you thinking about?
I was thinking about when I first came out, and I guess I had a boyfriend at that time. I don't remember exactly, but someone asked me the question, so when you dance, who leads? And my first thought was, what a stupid, trivial question. And it's obviously a question that is a proxy for all sorts of other questions, mm-hmm. right? Now I look at it and I'm like, who leads? What is this, 1952? I mean...
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, you know, we don't do the foxtrot, but actually.
I don't think there's anybody watching this video. I mean, there might be a few people who are watching this video who think that question was about dancing, but that question wasn't about no dancing, baby. They wanted to know who was climbing up on top. That's what they wanted to know. And assuming that the person climbing on top wasn't the bottom. I'm just saying that if you want to be serious, right? But, you know, yeah, so I'm not going to ask you.
So maybe we can get into that next time.
We can get into that next time. But no, like, I mean, because I think there are people who are like, you know, how is it possible to have a long-distance relationship? It's like, do you guys hate each other? Are you, like, on the verge of, like, you know, you're, you know, one of those, you know, gay people who are benefiting from the fact that, you know, there are, you know, we're equal marriage rights in New York City and now on a national level. Like, you know, what? So what is it, you know, where... How would you categorize, like, and again, in a nutshell, categorize this relationship for people who are asking that question? And what is it, and I mean for you, not what you assume it is for me.
That's one of those questions where I just, my honest answer is, I wouldn't. I mean, I wouldn't categorize it. I don't think that's... It's helpful to try to say the characteristics of this relationship are X, Y, and Z. It's what it is. It's my relationship with you. It will be what it's going to be. And I don't feel... We're all making it up as we go along. And I think our parents were all making it up as they were going along, although there were more norms, and the norms were more strictly enforced, you know, 40, 50 years ago. But... It's what it is. Deal with it. That's my response to that question.
All right.
That's not very helpful. I'm sorry. But
I'm sure that there are a lot of people who are listening to that and are probably running wild with it and likely in some of the best ways. You know, there's this saying, and I think it comes out of, it's a saying coming out of Latin America, and I don't know the original Spanish, but it's, we make the road by walking. And I feel like, you know, if we're creating a new world, we have to really be willing to reevaluate all of the institutions that we have now. And I kind of appreciate the fact that is happening even on a personal level in this particular relationship. Which, again, we'll get more into details. So patience, everyone, patience. But for now, I'm going to call it quits. I actually did finish my smoothie. Chris has barely touched his. But We gotta go. We got auditions to sit in on today. So thanks all of you. Be sure, if you haven't had a chance to visit my Patreon page, please do. It really helps. It really helps because I, you know, I'm pretty much daily vlogging these days. Thanks, Chris, for sitting down for this big chunk of time and talking to all these strangers who are gonna say things. So be nice, you guys. Anyway, that's...
You're welcome.
Oh, thank you. That's it for this video. Like it if you like it. Share it, comment, subscribe. This is Reg and Chris signing off. Love yourselves. Peace.
And I love myself. The world is a ghetto because of Dinge. I love myself.